Good evening, everyone. My name is Tricia Paik, the Curator of Contemporary Art here at the IMA, and I'm so pleased to have all of you here gathered for us to welcome artists Mariam Ghani and Erin Ellen Kelly. I'm honored that they came to visit with us today, and this conversation is organized in conjunction with their current exhibition, Mariam Ghani, Erin Ellen Kelly, Water, Land, City, which has been a trilogy we've been showing for the past year. And we are now on our third video. And I hope you might have seen the first two, Like Water from a Stone and Landscape Studies New Mexico. We'll be showing clips of that if you haven't seen it. And I invite you all to see The City and the City, the current video on view, which will be up in the galleries on the fourth floor until November 6th. So I please invite you to see that. We'll be talking a little bit about that video as well. But before I invite Mariam and Erin on stage, I first wanted to say a few words of thanks and as well to share some background information about both artists. Of course, first I want to thank Mariam and Erin for traveling through the rain from New York City, making through some challenging delays. We're so happy to have you here. It's been such a great experience collaborating with you both, and looking forward to continue to working with you in the future. And of course, I want to thank gallerist Jeff Lee of Ryan Lee Gallery in New York City, who represents Mariam, and thanking him for coming and all of his support. But before I introduce both of the artists, I wanted to make sure that I thank my exceptional colleagues, most of whom I don't think are here tonight, but that's okay. I think most of you know my news that I will be bittersweetly leaving the IMA. Next Wednesday is my last day. I'm gonna become the director of the Mount Holyoke College Art Museum there. I would have never left for another curatorial position at another museum. I was very, very happy here, but just being given that opportunity, I had to take that chance. So, but I wanna thank our director, Charles Venable, our deputy directors, Preston Bautista, Katie Hagen, Kim Gattle, for being such tremendous support on all the projects that I've done here. And I want to give a huge blanket thanks to the incredibly committed and talented staff here at the IMA who've made all the contemporary projects here possible. One person I have to mention by name, and she'll be embarrassed forever, but hopefully she'll be appreciative, is Elizabeth Smith, who is the curatorial assistant in the contemporary department, and she has been my right-hand woman for the past year plus, and she's been my partner and collaborator in everything you've done together, and it's been such an honor and pleasure working with you, and I know that a number of people have come up to me and thanked me personally for bringing her here. I didn't do that, I just invited her to apply, she applied, and then luckily we connected, and I'm excited to see all the great things she's gonna do here at the IMA, and then also outside, as she's doing a lot of curatorial projects. And last but not least, I want to thank all of you for your commitment and your interest in contemporary art and in art in general and being supporters of the museum. This is the reason why the IMA exists, for people like you who come out in the rain wanting to hear from great artists like Mariam and Erin. So I want to thank you so much for your commitment. And not a day has gone by that I walked around the museum when I came in every day while working here and just was struck by the distinctiveness of the IMA. It is the only encyclopedic museum in the country and maybe even in the world that rests on 152 acres of land, that has a 35-acre lake, a canal that connects to a river, two historic homes, one here and one in Columbus, Indiana, as you all know. It's an exceptional place, and I'm quite disappointed I won't be able to be a part of the next chapter, but I'm excited to see it from afar and come back on a visit. So please also do come and visit me in Western Mass. So a little bit about Mariam and Erin. So first of all, as a contemporary curator, whenever you go around all the big fairs and exhibitions, for example, in Venice or at Documenta, you're always struck with seeing just way too many artists in such a condensed period of time. And even though I have my handy moleskin down and my iPhone now to take pictures, I can't remember every artist that I see and what they made. But what always resonates with me after I go on my long trips that I'm very, have the privilege of going to, I sit back, I don't look at my moleskin, and then I think about who I remember, whether the work is great or even whether the work is bad, because we all know that bad work can also be great, because when Pablo Picasso showed his friends Les Demoiselles d'Avignon in 1907 to friends in Paris, they said, some said, like, it felt like they were drinking kerosene, or Matisse's paintings too, or even Monet. So I always question the works that I walk away that I didn't like right away. But Mariam Ghani's work, when she showed and was a collaboration also with Erin, when I saw it at Documenta, which is a leading contemporary exhibition that happens every 5 years in Kassel, Germany, I walked into this one space and saw this dual-channel video called A Brief History of Collapses. And admittedly, Mariam and Erin, I didn't have time to watch the entire thing. But, because you don't have time, there is enough time. But when I walked in, I knew immediately there was something distinctive about the artist's vision and what they were trying to achieve. And I didn't even know what the goal was and the subject matter. I just knew that it was something exceptional, and I hadn't seen something like that ever. And I don't even think I just loved it so much. I don't even think I wrote it down in my notebook. I'll have to check. Fast forward to my time in St. Louis, and Mariam applied for a fellowship at the St. Louis Art Museum that was in collaboration with Washington University, and my colleague administering that part of the program at Washington University, and I just jumped for joy when we saw that Mariam had applied. This is the artist! This is the artist who did that Brief History of Collapse, the documentary. We literally got up and did a jig. We were so thrilled. So that's my intro to Mariam. And just to brag a little bit about her, she received her BA from New York University and her MFA from the School of Visual Arts in New York. She has shown in significant group exhibitions and film festivals, such as those at the Guggenheim in New York, the 14th International Film Festival in Rotterdam, Netherlands, Documenta in Kassel, the Sharjah Biennial, Projects for Creative Time, and the list goes on and on. And of course, she showed at the St. Louis Art Museum, as well as one of the modern Mondays at MoMA. Erin is also based in New York, a New York-based dancer, performer, and choreographer, and her solo and collaborative performances have been featured at numerous festivals, exhibitions, and alternative spaces, such as, I'm gonna demolish the German, Kunsthaus, I'm not even gonna say it, T-A-C-H-E-L-E-S, for a month of performance, art, and culture in Spanwerk, Berlin, Documenta as well, Art Basel, the movement research at Judson Church, the New York Buteau Festival, and 57th Street Art Time, both in New York and in Berlin. So without further ado, please help me welcome Mariam Ghani and Erin Ellen Kelly to the stage. Since some of you might not have seen, had the opportunity yet to see any of the videos upstairs during the trilogy, we thought it would be helpful for you to see at least one clip, which is from Like Water from a Stone. So that'll be a 4-minute clip. And Mariam, you have the...
All right, so we'll just start off with this clip from Like Water from a Stone. If you can bring the sound up, please.
Thank you.
Okay.
So that's just to give you some sense of their visual practice. And I thought we'll talk more about this work in the coming conversation, but what I always like to do in these conversations is start from the very beginning mm-hmm. and first ask both artists how they began their practice and how they chose working in video as well as in choreography and dance. So Mariam, you can explain how you got to video and what drew you to that practice.
Right, okay. So it started while I was studying comparative literature at NYU. This was in the 90s when anything could be a text. And it's the heyday of deconstructivism. So basically you could study pretty much anything and say it was a text for comparative literature purposes. And I was at NYU, so I sort of wandered over to the film school. The reason I did that, the reason I started taking video classes, was because of Mona Hatoum's 1998 show at the New Museum. So I saw that show, and at the same time, I was taking a comparative literature class where we were assigned to see all of Walid Raad's videos up to that point, all of Jay Saloom's videos up to that point, and all of Elia Suleiman's films up to that point, as well as Mufida Tlatli's films. And a series of other kind of practices from the Middle East. So that, in combination with Mona Hatoum's 1998 show at the New Museum, was this moment where I was like, huh, you can do that with video? Maybe I should investigate this. And then I got into an editing room, and it was like discovering a language you already speak. It just made sense to me immediately.
But were you doing another practice at the time?
I was a writer. I thought of myself as a writer. But I had also studied dance pretty seriously up until I was 18. And I was, at the time, still training in voice. I was training in bel canto. So I was training as a singer as well. And the amazing thing about video, as I found, especially as I got deeper into it, was that it was really a medium where I could combine everything that I was interested in. All the different kinds of media that I was interested in exploring really could come together in this one space.
Okay.
Wonderful answer.
I grew up as a competitive gymnast, which is a very athletic approach to the body. So I did that till I was about 15, and my body basically imploded. And it was riddled with injuries and surgery and but had complete this like a lot of information and a lot of knowledge within it and a lot of training. But the approach, this kind of very, very militant approach to the body was, I needed to break from that. And so I started studying film and photography and what I became obsessed with within that genre was there was this movie Tetsuro Iron Man, and it's a stop animation Japanese movie, and it's this body is like becoming iron, and the body in the way that the body is moving through the frame and the way the body is deconstructing fascinated me, and so I became very interested in how the body moves in frame, and then I was working. When you're young, you're working with a lot of different people, and there was a collective group that I was working with that was kind of asking to do more performative works. And so I got back into using my body within the context of my practice, and then got fascinated with dance and started taking movement classes more seriously in the downtown dance scene in New York, because there's like room for a lot of that, and like a lot of meditative practices and Qigong and Japanese Buto, and started there and kind of really started performing a lot more. It just kind of happened. I was young and open.
Mm-hmm. Well, it seems like both of your practices are really grounded in the conceptual approach and with kind of intellectual rigor. If you know the artists that were inspiring you, like Mona Hatoum, mm-hmm. but also you know images and images of the issues of the body, and also yours is also actually, if I understand you correctly, you're actually investigating really how the body functions mm-hmm. every day, and not choreography as in like a true dance routine. You know, it's not the kind of artificial approach to dance. What I view is what you do and what you work with Mariam is and now I'm skipping to my next topic, which I want to get to later, but is how you break down just how the body functions in life. And I think with your ideas too, Mariam, is where you choose the idea place, you're just breaking down the history and basic elements that I think a lot of people just kind of take it for granted, which leads me to my next question is how you started collaborating together. I know that you've been working together since 2006. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of us here would be interested to hear how you might have met and mm-hmm. you know, where was the meeting of the minds, and then we can get to more of the nitty gritty that I was starting to go into, but
right.
we can talk about that first.
Yeah. Well, we met through a mutual friend that I went to graduate school with at SVA, who's also a photographer. And we were friends for a while before we found an opportunity to collaborate. And we had been talking a lot about our work and about, you know, our interests and our kind of ideas around our practices. And from those conversations, we really developed a desire to collaborate, but we didn't have the space and the time and the resources to make it happen. The space and time and resources came out of a specific residency. So we're going to actually show you. We're going to actually show you that that particular video. But let me just say very quickly a little bit about like Water from a Stone. While we've got these images up, I just want to point out a few things to talk about, like what is behind our approach to these sites that we're working in, and a few of the kind of influences that are coming in. So for example, you can see in the imagery of like Water from a Stone, one of the resources we're drawing from is the Romantic Nationalist painting movement in Norway in the 19th century. It's really influencing the composition of these particular frames. That was a big part of the kind of composition of imagery for this particular film. Another thing that was happening here is we were really picking particular sites. It's actually like a geological timeline. So the clip you saw was from the first two sections of the film, which is this site Vigdel, which is actually, these are rocks that were formed during the Ice Age. This place, Svartholla, traces of human habitation have been found from 5600 BC.
The cave boy.
Yeah, the cave boy.
A boy was found fully intact, like within the site, in the fetal position. It had like gone to sleep and and they had like found him. So like that, and we kept going, that cave boy site.
And the sea used to come all the way to the mouth of this cave. At one time, it used to actually reach all the way there. We're sort of continuing forward through time. These are these stone walls that were basically made by farmers in this story we kept hearing from people's childhoods where before oil in Norway, every spring the thawing of the frost would push rocks up out of the field and people would have to go, like the kids of the family would go and pick these rocks out and put them into the walls. Every spring they did that. They would pick more rocks out of the fields and make these walls with them. And we've actually seen with our own eyes that now people just hire bulldozers to do it. So that's how Norway has changed with the oil money.
But the location on the other site, we went to the house. It used to be mm-hmm. on, like, it was like up on this mountain that you had to hike up to get to it. And the man who lived there before had his house and he had his stone walls. But when Norway came into their oil money, they offered to build a road for him to get closer to his house via like car, and he declined the road mm-hmm. and preferred to walk and have that time in nature and take, he said, if I need a rest, I'll sit on a rock. Mm-hmm. And we were basically staying in this man's former house and on his land, and he had lived there for 80 years, born and raised in the same house until he was 80 years old and had to go into town when he turned 80 to go to the
retirement home. Yeah. And then these are installations left over from the Nazi occupation of Norway. So these are the bunkers that they put in along the sea line, along the coast of Norway. So you know, this is a little bit like, and then this is finally going into the urban space of Stavanger. These are new developments that are being put up along the coastline in Stavanger inside the city space. And it actually, the film actually ends with that image that we saw that while we were waiting to kind of convene the conversation, which is this playground that's next to the Petroleum Museum, which is made of parts that have been discarded from oil rigs. So that's the sort of end of our timeline, is the moment when the oil sort of really changes everything in Norway.
Before you go to fugitive,
fugitive
phrase. It is. I was like, it is fugitive.
It is fugitive phrase.
Before we go to that, I wanted to make one comment because I think that's what makes these videos so strong is that I'm sure many of you had a similar experience where you look at art, usually contemporary art, where the artist sometimes doesn't give you enough information or clues to better understand what the work is about. And if you do give time to this, to videos like this, and you watch the length of it, you'll see the progression of how they're drawing up this narrative of ancient Norway to the present and what happens after the discovery of oil in the North Sea in 1969. So that's not necessarily told to you. It's not narrated in words, but it's narrated through the carefully framed images and the hint of the change of the dress that becomes, you know, that looks from olden days to modern dress. So if you are a visitor who's paying attention, hopefully, and thinking, you might be able to get the narrative. So I think that's what's really strong about your work, is that it doesn't tell you everything right up front, but it layers the work, so you just, it's kind of like peeling back an onion, and then you finally get to the core and you're able to understand what the work is about. And that's what I admire about.
And a lot of these structures that we talk about when we're explaining the work, we're not necessarily expecting viewers to like pull this stuff out of viewing it, right? It's part of how we think about the work when we're making it. But you know, the main kind of animating idea of this particular work, I think, was really this idea of the genius loci, the spirit of place, and how each particular location that we were looking at in Norway, we were really thinking about, like, what is the spirit of that place? Because in Norwegian mythology, spirits of place are really personified, like they're actual, like, spirits in, like, this spooky sense of a spirit, right?
And there's ones for different places that inhabit different places. And with that, I mean, as a practice, as long as we're very clear and very precise around what that relationship is for us, then something will translate from that space. And it doesn't, like you say, have to be like a storybook narrative. But in my performative practice, as long as I become very clear on the relationship that the body is having and the spirit of the body is having to that place, and that clarity is between us, then the narrative unfolds and it can be a less linear or more abstract, but you will sense that history.
And I think, you know, in answer to your question about like why we started collaborating, it's really about this overlap between our interests that we found in our conversations before we started collaborating, which was this idea of like really thinking about site specificity and what it means to make something on site and in a site and about a site, and really responding to it in every part of the work. And you know, we talk about these works as performed places, and we really mean they're not performances made in places where the place is a backdrop. They're performances of the places, right? It looks like a really different thing than a performance in a place.
And I had been doing a series of live, like this kind of trend in theater where you have a warehouse space and you make installations and people walk through. And we had done our renegade warehouse tour in 1999 through like raw warehouses in Europe, and we were creating these spaces to perform in within and bringing them up and tearing them down and getting on the bus. And then the idea of like, well, it would be really nice to spend some time in one place and make the piece there instead of some concept of place that I'm creating every night. And so that's when the idea of like working with the actual site and location, documenting that process.
And also trying to make it equally specific to the medium of video.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay, so now let's show you a little bit of what we made the first time we actually did get to collaborate, which was through this residency at Schloss Solitude in Germany. So this was made partly in the Schloss itself, which is a Rococo-era Lustschloss, or pleasure palace.
And what year?
This is from 2006.
Okay.
And partly in the forest surrounding the Schloss, which was completely landscaped at the same time that the Schloss was built. So that's actually the very end of Fugitive Refrains. And Fugitive Refrains is actually named after a Wordsworth poem, a line from a Wordsworth poem, which is that nature yet remembers what was so fugitive. And it's really, you know, one of the things we were trying to think about in this particular work is this idea that, you know, this forest, which really just looks more or less like a natural space now, is actually like a pretty artificial landscape. Every single view from the path is perfect. It was completely landscaped, but it happened long enough ago that it has sort of decayed into naturalness. We were looking for these kind of traces of the original construction in the apparently natural landscape. And also like thinking about a lot of ideas to do with the Rococo aesthetic, mirrors and echoes, figure and ground, and the imitation, you know, all these imitations of nature, like this idea that artifice could imitate nature even better than nature could, you know, do the original thing.
And like decadence decayed in a way.
Yeah.
Like, you know, something that's been very indulged and then cannot sustain itself anymore.
But also a playfulness, yeah. Like there was a playfulness in it as well, because, you know, they actually did used to stage these sort of entertainments in the forest. There were parts of the forest that were designed to be these sort of like grottos where the nobles could play nymph and satyr, like, you know. So, you know, there's elements of that in it as well. And there's the whole Schloss was actually built for Karl Eugen's, the Duke at the time, his mistress. It was the pleasure palace.
Well, I think that's what for me what really strikes me about your work is this complete dedication to research. And so beyond the fact that you use this sense of place and discovery and that idea of the locus, that locus kernel, I think sets you apart. But beyond that, to further your practice and to create works that I think are so visually arresting, and each frame I'm always just so impressed by, but also the use of the body, but it's also the use of the research. I've kind of summarized for me why I think these works are so successful. I just took, for me, three fundamental principles, and we can talk about it whether you disagree or not. One is this commitment to research and understand the subject, mm-hmm. and this kind of rigorous exploration of your chosen place. Mm-hmm. And number two, your rendering of these carefully framed views that mm-hmm. you saw, and the images of the landscape. And even though it's a moving image, sometimes you just kind of hold onto, or you linger mm-hmm. on a particular frame view just a little bit longer or a little bit shorter, always leaving the viewer wanting a little bit more, which mm-hmm. I think is what you always want to do. And then number three is your use of the body and the incorporation of the body. Maybe my art historical knowledge of video is not as strong, but I've seen a lot of, you know, so-called performative work with the body, and I can't call to mind, someone can correct me, you can correct me, I can't really think about other video artists or film artists. I heard that she can use either video or film. I asked her today because I didn't know how you feel about that.
Lines are getting so blurry.
Yeah, very
days,
blurry.
It's like...
So it's no longer about the medium per se. It's just this whole... The moving image.
Is a really moving target.
So, but this idea of how in these various projects that Erin's able to respond to the land. And that's what I was talking about, that it's, you're a choreographer, but it's not dealing with kind of this artificial constructed choreography, but it's really responding to the land that I find really unique and really, I think, makes we as the viewer understand more about what's going on. Like you said, it's not about, you're not trying to like hit us over the head with it, but you're alluding to histories or understanding of the place. So before we get to the body, which I really want to get to, first I want to ask Mariam talk about how you develop first your vision for your films, mm-hmm. And selecting the place, and then afterward I want to hear from Erin about how you imagine your performances within each unique mm-hmm. space, because you must go see The City and the City, which we'll talk about soon. Upstairs, because there's this one passage where she's doing just something devastating with her body in response to this unique space. We talked about it earlier. You said that was so brutal on your body. And just the fact that the body can do what she did, it's pretty remarkable. So first about the aesthetic vision.
Right. Well, different projects constitute themselves differently. Like the collaboration is a flexible, it's a flexible thing, and it constructs itself differently for different projects. But in general, we're selecting locations together. Sometimes, like with A Brief History of Collapses, the location's kind of a fixed thing, like it's a single building or two single buildings, or like with Three Surrenders, it's also like one space that's like very fixed at the beginning of the project. But with most of our projects, the location scouting is such an enormous part of the piece. We have a general idea, like we're making a project in Southwest Norway, or we're making a project around the Galisteo Valley, New Mexico. But to find the specific sites, that's something we do very much together, because they have to answer to criteria for both of us. We both have to find something that speaks to us there. And then it's a question for me, in terms of like how I frame things, that also can be different for different projects. Sometimes there's a really specific set of aesthetic concerns that come from the conceptual basis of the project. So in Fugitive Refrains, everything was really being filtered through this concern with the Rococo. So everything's filmed through something else. Because we're playing so much with figure and ground, I was working a lot with rack focusing in a lot of the film. So it's really like there's a lot of play with figure and ground. I didn't actually show you a section that's a good example of that. I showed you a section that's a good example of another feature of a lot of our films, which is the long static take. Because we've been really interested in slowness and stillness. From the very beginning of our collaboration, slowness and stillness has been important.
Yeah.
Duration has been really important to us. In other projects, how things are filmed or edited, it comes, from the kind of overall structural concerns of the piece. Like in Smile, You're in Sharjah, all the cuts are on movement except the shots of the facades. But everything else is cut on movement. And a lot of the shots are also, like really concerned with finding the movement in the frame. We're filming things that are moving through the frame so that we can make these cuts on movement because it's a study of how people move through the city.
So Erin, are you coming up with kind of rough drafts of what you might want to do when you're out in a specific space, or are you testing and practicing it out before?
I like to walk around and sit, and I do spend time, sometimes more time, sometimes less, depending on the conditions. Like, I mean, there are places where we've arrived and realize we're losing light and we really, really want to shoot there and we've just got to figure it out. Right. And that's you're on the spot. And for me, like when you're asking what I'm concerned with, or like it's brutal on my body, and I said I came from gymnastics, and like, well, why would you want to be so brutal on your body again? It's more the approach is finding the spirit of the place in a certain way. And sometimes certain spaces ask that, and sometimes you have to go through discomfort to find your way through and in. And so it's from a different spot in which I'm not one thing is imposing on the body very strict structure of approach. The other is from a point of listening, and listening with in the back of your brain all these kind of conceptual parameters that we're working with. And then you're in the space, and I spend time walking and sitting, and that in a sense is listening. And sometimes things aren't easy. what has happened in the land or in that location or in that space is not like pleasant. Mm. And so it's not like my responsibility to relive that, but it's more like what is it calling out? Mm. And to open the body to let that pass through.
Mm. That's a perfect segue for landscape studies.
Yeah, it's a good segue for landscape studies. Yeah, and I mean, you can't evoke the spirit of the North Sea, like in Norway, without, you know, actually suffering the cold, cold North Sea, unfortunately.
That's fine.
Yeah.
So you want to say? So this is Landscape Studies New Mexico, mm-hmm. from 2008 to 2010. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's a little tiny taste of Landscape Studies New Mexico. That was the second film that we showed in the trilogy. Do you want to share a few thoughts about that, or let people just imagine what that's about?
What it was like to actually come up from under the...
I still breathe a sigh of relief. Every time I see your nostrils and your mouth, I'm just like...
I really wanted to have those heads coming up from underground.
You started talking about it while we were still driving cross country to New Mexico. And then when we got there, we got to Galisteo and we started reading a book of Pueblo mythology that was in
Tewa
the house
people.
We were, yeah, of the Tewa people that was in the house we were staying in. And it turns out their origin myth is that they actually came up from under the ground.
So the image then was like, okay, we got to figure out a way to do this. And
we filmed it in Madrid, which is a coal mining. It's an old coal mining town.
So that's why all of this and really
very loose scree
and very dry.
Yeah.
So it was a place where, because I mean, otherwise it would be very hard to get dig down with limited resources.
Yeah.
But we found a place where the soil was loose enough, and
yeah.
Yeah, and then you just in any of these situations, you kind of drop into a certain calm. Like for me, it's like you drop into a certain calm of rest, and then let the impetus come from like the guts up and out. So I guess that's my response to that's what that experience was.
So this is a great one to kind of talk about the research process more in depth, because this is you might have heard her say the date is 2008 to 2010. The reason it has this very long kind of hatching process is because we went there first and then we did the research afterwards, which is not the way we normally like to do things, but that's just kind of how this one happened. It all sort of came together very, very, very quickly, and someone just sort of said, I think you can make something interesting in New Mexico. Here's a house in Galisteo for 2 weeks. And we just drove there, figured out a structure, which was basically all of our work has sections. It sort of, there's always sections in our videos, which are more or less apparent to the viewer. They're usually between like 3 and 5 minutes, the kind of sections. And here, each section is a color and a direction, because in the kind of Tewa mythology, like every direction has a color, including above and below. So north, south, west, east, above and below. Each direction is represented by a section that's also really dominated by that color in the film.
And that's a very common practice when you start researching a lot of like different origin myths and spiritual practices. There's directional based, elemental based qualities within directions that correspond to colors, and then a whole plethora of other things.
Right. Then, you know, based on what we ended up shooting, which, you know, it was really just the two of us. We had a sewing machine, a bunch of stuff we'd bought in thrift stores on the way, which we sewed into costumes based on the locations that we found. Sometimes I was sewing in the car on the way to the location. Like, yeah, that was, it was rapid. It was.
In Mariam's Toyota.
Everything was improvised. The alignment was never the same after driving on a dirt road to Madrid. Corollas are not meant to off-road.
So, Mariam, we're butting up a little bit on time, and I want to make sure we talk a little bit about the city and the city, because I selfishly also want to ask you my quartet of questions. I think some in the audience know these questions.
So, I mean, the last thing I want to say about Landscape Studies New Mexico is that it really... we ended up developing a lot of other kind of material around it after we... after we shot it, including all these kind of, this sort of series of text photo, this kind of photo text series, where different kind of readings for the images are proposed.
Is that your writing?
This is a letter, a sort of imaginary letter from Elsie Clues Parsons to her family. Elsie Parsons wrote the kind of anthropology book, Pueblo Indian Religion, and she's a very prominent ethnographer of New Mexico, and also a really interesting kind of early feminist, but you know, very controversial for many different reasons. So this is sort of in the spirit of our New Mexico is very important to like the history of American ethnography and anthropology and archaeology. There's many different people who come to New Mexico as strangers and have important experiences for them, which they then kind of impose on the landscape of New Mexico in different ways, which we found to be also in some ways our experience as people coming to New Mexico as strangers, making something about the landscape of New Mexico, and also finding very often that we were shooting in landscapes that had already been used by other films. For example, the White Sand Desert, which of course is famously the site of many missile tests, but also was used in The Man Who Fell to Earth as an alien landscape, and also other films as an alien landscape. It's very often an alien landscape in American cinema. So these are some of the missiles that have been tested at White Sands. Mm-hmm. We became really interested in this idea of like landscape studies and landscape archaeology as they were invented in New Mexico, and as they have been thought about through the New Mexico landscape. And it became actually really important to our research method going forward from this project. Actually, the notion of landscape studies and the notion of the methods of landscape archaeology.
And then you continue that with St. Louis for the City in the City, which is the video on view, which we're not showing for you tonight. Mm-hmm. So you must see it before November 6th. Mm-hmm. And Erin's actually from St. Louis, and there was a nice convergence because you applied for the fellowship to do the project and for the St. Louis Art Museum and to teach at Washington University. And you already were inspired by... I've never known how to say the last name, China Mayville? Mayville's noir novel, The City in the City. And we're already going to explore this kind of issue of St. Louis being a divided city. And then Ferguson happened, and then you arrived, and then you made this work drawing from the archaeology and the landscape of St. Louis. And maybe just a few comments about that project, and then I'll ask you my questions.
Okay. Well, it happened a little bit differently.
Okay, sorry.
we had talked. I mean, the project had been planned for quite a while before the shooting of Michael Brown.
No. You were always going to do that already.
Well, we weren't going to use the China Mieville novel.
Oh, okay. I thought you were always going to work on that.
We were always going to make a project about the overlap between spatial politics and racial politics in St. Louis.
In class.
Yeah, we were very interested in those questions. We'd been talking about that for a while, as part of the kind of lead up to this project, and then everything happened right before we're going to start actually working on it, and then it became a different set of questions because then we were working like in the middle of an emergency. And it becomes a different context, and it becomes a different mode of working because it's working in a crisis, like in a moment of crisis, and also in the middle of a protest movement, which itself was performing every single day of that month of October when we were filming. They were producing these performances of protest and protest performances, and a lot of artists were involved in making things for that movement. And making kind of very strong images, actually, that we couldn't ignore, but that we also didn't want to appropriate. So that's a very delicate balance to have to strike.
And wasn't one of the works made during that time, was that the mirrored casket that was unveiled at the new museum of the Smithsonian Museum now in D.C. for African American Culture and History?
That's right, and that's why. That's why the dead men in the film, The City in the City, which did end up taking this plot from China Mieville's novel, which starts with a murder, and in my version is narrated by, in our version it's narrated by the dead man. The dead man only ever appears as like a series of shattered mirrors, which is, an allusion to that mirrored casket. And the film is also narrated by one of the people who made the mirror casket. What do you want to say about the improvisations and the kind of choice of locations?
Well, I feel like just to like reiterate how intelligent and quick and mobile the protest movement that was happening, and how in awe and admiration I had for that, and the desire though to keep something rooted in this concept of place in a state of crisis and. Having very limited amount of time and working with people that were really directly within my community and art like that I had grown up around and going back to there and the people that were in the piece are like high school friends of mine's children. And just resourcing it from that place.
Yeah. So basically the decision to use The City in the City, the Mayville novel, I think came out of, you know, this balancing act that we felt we needed to strike between the moment of emergency and the need to you know, be like, make something that was relevant to the moment, but also that didn't try to like appropriate the movement. So it's that sort of layer of fiction that comes in through the narrative that's borrowed from the Mayville novel, this science fiction that isn't really a science fiction, this idea of the city that becomes so divided it actually becomes two separate countries. That, I think, you know, gave it this like one layer of remove that actually made it much more effective in the St. Louis context. It actually weirdly made everyone able to relate to it, yeah. No matter where they stood vis-a-vis the movement.
Well, exactly, yeah. And what's really tragic is that this video, this film now has more meaning, unfortunately, because mm-hmm. what we went through this summer with more yeah. violence in yeah. the city. So it's a wonderful work. So I hope you see it. It's very incisive. It's brutal at some points, and it's mm-hmm. devastating and beautiful as well. So. I have to close my questions because, and we'll keep them short because we're past 7:30 and I want to, I know I'm still leaving you guys wanting more, but we are a little bit over time, so I apologize. I will first ask Erin and then you can answer this question, Mariam, mm-hmm. although I think I know the answer from you from based on what we just talked about, but do you have any specific memories of when you first realized you wanted to become a creative artist? For example, was there a turning point in your life when you made this decision? Hmm. A specific memory.
when I was a kid and I listened to James Brown, and I would love to dance, and then it just was like this rhythm, the rhythm, and so I asked for a drum set at age 5, which my father, who did not live with me, happily provided. my mother's, and so we had it in my mother's two-room apartment, which my mom was really okay with. And I would say that, like, at that moment, this feeling the energy of music.
Yeah. Parents never stifle your children. Mariam?
With art, like with becoming an artist, I would say it's the Mona Hatoum show, and specifically the video Measures of Distance. With like being creative in general, maybe the Milorad Pavic novel Dictionary of the Khazars, and
I haven't read that.
Thinking of that, I'm like, maybe that's why I made Afghanistan a lexicon. Maybe that's why I wrote it in the form of a dictionary. I never thought of that before.
Oh, there you go. Well, to my next question, number 2. What has been the most important book or essay to influence and shape your thinking about your art and why?
Well, that also changes. Mm. And there's several, and there's one that I want to go back. I just was thinking today on the plane that I want to go back and read, and that's Thoreau's, there's like a couple essays on Thoreau with the eyeball, the transcendental eyeball. And I remember it, and I need to reread it because there's like the memory of it is kind of knocking at the door. And so I want to revisit that. And I love the writing of Sam Shepard, the poems, poetry and prose section, More Than the Plays, Resonate, and The Body Artist by Don DeLillo. And then there's female artists in there, writers in there as well. But I was shocked that Don DeLillo actually could capture this essence of a very ephemeral moment and the capacity of the body to hold these almost transparent states and spaces that would last briefly in and out of a tangible form.
Hmm.
Beautiful. Mariam?
Edward Said was really important for me in my 20s, like super, super important.
Can you share a little more for people who might not know?
Orientalism and culture and imperialism. The whole idea of contrapuntal narratives, which I took very literally in my early work, very literally. That was very important to me.
Okay. Number three for Erin, what do you believe is the role of art in culture and society today? I had always a corollary that I never always added in, but mainly, to be more clear about this question is, what do you believe is the role of art in culture and society today? Is basically, do you believe art can change society or have an impact on society?
Well, I would hope so. Yes. I mean, it's my way of feeling connected to this life that I live, and that's my way of connecting to the people around me and the society that I live in. And so, yes. And I mean, not me personally being the facilitator of that change, but being changed by the experience of practice. And that's what art is to me. It's a practice and a vulnerability and a dialogue.
I mean, I've said a lot of stuff about this.
If you don't want to answer, that's okay.
I mean, basically, I feel like if you're talking about concrete change, art is most effective as the thin end of a wedge. So artists need to work in coalition with other groups, other actors who can follow up on the sort of openings that art makes. So what art is good at is reaching people on a kind of instinctual level, on an emotional level, scaling things down to the human, to the specific, to the personal, taking a really abstract big idea and making it like specific and personal and human again. But then you need somebody to enter into that opening with actual direct action items, with actual like grassroots like work on the ground, which artists are much less good at doing that kind of follow-through, follow-up, long-term change-making stuff. Mostly because of the way the art world is structured, which is like constantly moving us from place to place like every 6 weeks. That's how I feel about that.
And the last question for artists in the audience, do you have any advice for artists just starting out?
Perseverance. I mean, it's for me, I mean, there's so many different kinds of advice, but I would just say perseverance.
You will get a lot of no's before you get a yes. But I think there's Auden, W.H. Auden? Is it a yes to best your every no? Also, time will say nothing, but I told you so.
Very good. Speaking of time, we'll just have one question if anyone wants to ask a question, then we'll close. I'm sorry we went over time. Yes, Diane.
One element of the work that you have talked about is sound. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Question about sound.
Yeah, that's a great question. All the works that we showed you today have scores by the composer Qasim Naqvi, who some of you might also know as the drummer for the band Dawn of Midi. Qasim was actually, we were individually friends with Qasim before we started collectively collaborating with him. He's a really important part also of our collaboration. And sound is a really important part of the work. A lot of these videos, when shown as installations, have either quadraphonic or spatialized 5.1 channel sound. So the sound is really meant to fulfill a function of kind of immersing you in the space, like really taking you bodily to the place in a way that like a flat screen can't do on its own. And in many cases, the sound is like, the score is another part of performing the place. And it's filling really specific functions in the kind of structure of the overall work.
And we always have a very, you know, we have a dialogue with Kasim, and we have fat, like, we record sound while we're traveling. He's been able to come on to some of the locations. And get a sense of what the piece is about. So it's like really also getting into the meat and challenging him. He challenges himself and pushes himself in new ways of working that aren't always the same. Mm-hmm. So he comes up with a new idea and we'll try out. He's like, for this one, I think it might call a choral score. You know, like we're talking about it. I can do this. So I think that that also, in ways that which each location challenge us, he takes that challenge on as well.
Yeah, like the Norway project, like Water from Stone, is a great example. We were talking about that project before we started shooting it. We talked with Kasim about it. We were talking about the extended vocal scene in Norway, and how like vocal music is a really important part of the new music scene in Norway. And we thought, we all were thinking, well, a choral score would be a great idea for this piece. Kasim had never done a choral, like a big choral work before. So we recorded ambient sound while filming, and the choral score is based on the ambient sound that was recorded while filming. So all the sound that you hear is made by the singers, including the kind of like wind noises and all that. That's just like them whistling. And yeah, everything like is just voiced. Yeah.
Thank you for that question. That was something else I was going to ask. So thank you. So thank you very much for everyone for coming out tonight, and thanks so much to Mariam and Erin for coming to visit us here
thank
in Indianapolis.
All.